start saying you don't even need it.
We don't be doing that again.
We filled that up this morning, Carolyn did. She's getting hit every week. We got a guy who rides a moped. He pulls up and usually takes like one or two cans of soup or something like that. And then he leaves. And then he'll come back in a couple days and he'll take another can of something. Then we have another vehicle, a couple other vehicles that come in and they take a good bit. But they've been taking the Bibles, the storybook, whatever we put in there, taking it off. Soap, food, toothpaste, no matter. They taking everything that people need it. So, regardless, we doing our part.
Amen.
So, we just hope it's being taken for the right reason. Other than that, the only announcement I have is we have choir practice tonight at 4. Anybody welcome to come. And our next family of faith will be January the 4th. I don't know who we're going to have to eat yet. We haven't discussed that. We ain't went that far. But that's what we have going on right now. Since it's January 4th, we all probably going to have our New Year resolutions, so we might have salad. Just kidding. But that's all I have for right now. Next Sunday. Sunday night, we're going to do a candlelight service. It's something we do to remember our lost loved ones. And we're going to do something a little bit different this year, I do believe. We're going to try something different. But it's still the same principle behind it. So, really don't want to go into all detail. It's going to be kind of a surprise for everybody. But I think it's going to be a good thing. I think it's going to be a good thing. But, I need to talk to Virginia. Is she okay?
Yeah, she got a great grandbaby. She couldn't make it this morning.
Okay. We talked about baptizing her.
Yeah.
So I like to do that Sunday morning.
Next Sunday morning?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
All right. My God. I
like to do that Sunday morning. So, but that's all I got right now. Turn it over to our minister of music.
Let's see, page 265, so first, second, last, words are up here. We don't know how to use it, so we're going to do it up though.
You said we didn't need it, did you?
Yeah.
The first Noel.
All the cold winters.
Heavenly Father, once again, let us come to your house again this morning. Father, thank you for the food we had last night, Father, the fellowship building. Father, thank you for the sister and the brother, fellowship building. Thank you for the way you prepared the food last night, Father. And Father, I hope and pray, Father, that the message you bring on for these for this morning, Father, everyone in here get blessed, Father. And if there's one in here that don't know you, Father, as a Savior, I hope and pray today will be the day to get right with you.
Yes, yes.
And thank you, Father, for everything you do for us. And take this offering and use your glory in Jesus' name, I pray.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. If we had sang another song.
They have to wait on the old man to get down, don't they?
Big Dave's gonna sing.
Not this morning.
You missed it, he didn't hear it.
I did it the other week, but not this morning. You never know, right? You never know. You never know. I'm gonna be speaking this morning out of Book of Luke. Book of Luke, chapter 1. I guess God put on me chapter 1 this morning because I know we got a lot of Clemson fans here and they don't count real well. So I figured they can get to chapter 1. I figured they'd get to chapter 1. You know me, I get jabbing every once in a while. But I'm going to be reading Luke chapter 1, verse 5 through 25. I know y'all thinking, man, he going to preach out of 20 verses? We'll see. There was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zacharias of the course of Abia, and his wife was the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord blameless. And they had no child, because that Elizabeth was barren, and they both were now well stricken in years. And it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. And the whole multitude of the people were praying without at the time of incense. And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, Fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard. And thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. And thou shalt have joy and gladness so many, and many shall rejoice at his birth. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, and he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost even from his mother's womb. And many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God. And he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elias to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And Zacharias said unto the angel, Whereby shall I know this? For I am old, an old man, and my wife well stricken in years. And the angel answered, said unto him, I am Gabriel, that stand in the presence of God, and am sent to speak unto thee, and to show thee these glad tidings. And behold, thou shalt be dumb, and not able to speak, until the day that these things shall be performed. Because thou believest not in my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season. And the people waited for Zacharias, and marveled that he tarried so long in the temple. And when he came out, he could not speak unto them. And they perceived that he had seen a vision in the temple, for he beckoned unto them and remained speechless. And it came to pass that as soon as the days of his ministration were accomplished, he departed to his own house. And after those days, his wife Elizabeth conceived and hid herself 5 months, saying, Thus hath the Lord dealt with me in the days wherein he looked on me to take away my reproach among men. Lord, Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word, Father. Now I ask you to touch my tongue and give me what you need me to say, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
This is the only place in the Bible where it talks about John the Baptist's parents. And that's what we're going to talk about, his parents. John was a great preacher. He was a great preacher. He comes after a part that God was quiet for around about 400 years. He didn't send any prophets. He didn't send anything out. God was just sitting there doing his thing and letting the people of Israel just sit there. But how do you not love John? He comes preaching up out of the woods, wearing camel hair for clothes. Guess that's why I wore this suit today. It's about camel hair collar. He got camel clothes hair on, a leather belt, eating grasshoppers.
You don't do that.
And honey. I like some honey. Eating grasshoppers and honey. So how you not love him? And I'm going to tell you why you should love him. Because when he come out of the woods preaching, what did he say first? Repent. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. That's what he come out saying. That's enough said right there. That's enough said right there. If I quit right there, that'd be good enough, but I'm not. But I'm not. But repent. And you ask, how did he come out of the womb filled with the Holy Ghost? I'm going to tell you why. His father was a godly and righteous man. His mother was a godly and righteous mother. And they come together, he come out godly and righteous. Because the Holy Ghost touched them. They're filled with the Holy Ghost. I love it when a family comes to worship together. When the daddy and the mama comes and their kids come, I love that. I've seen families that just the daddy worships. I've seen families just the mama worships. I've seen the same family just the children worship. But I love it when it all comes together and everybody comes to worship together. That is a beautiful thing. That's just a beautiful thing when a family comes to worship together. But in verse 8 and 9, it says, and it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course, okay, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was burning incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. That was his job. You know, he's a priest, he's a preacher. They call him a priest, but he's a preacher, okay? But when he went to the temple, his job was to go there and pray, light the incense, get all that going. That was his job. It kind of, right there it says it was a custom, okay? I like customs. I think, you know, it's a good thing. Today's church is a lot like yesterday's church. We still have Sunday morning service, Sunday night service, some type of midweek service, okay? And customs are good. Customs are good. But we have to be careful that we just don't get in that rut of doing it. You know, we go to church on Sunday morning, that's what we always done. We have to be careful with that. It can get dangerous that we just do it because we're supposed to do it. You should do it because you come to see God.
Amen.
You come to worship God. You come to see what he's going to do. You come to see if he's going to move. He's going to move in here today. That's what we want. We want to feel his presence. We just don't want to just come here and show up like we watched a TV show. We want to come here and feel him and let him work through our lives.
Amen.
Are you looking for him to show up?
Yeah.
Do you want him to show up?
Yeah.
I want him to show up. And that's what we want. It ain't, like I said, it ain't just about just coming in here. It ain't just about just coming in here and being here. It's about wanting God to show up.
Amen.
And that's what we gotta want. Because we want him to show up, don't we?
That's right.
And that's what we gotta have. That's what, you know, like I said, we gotta be careful about them customs of just doing it just to do it. There's a reason why we're doing it. There's a reason why we are doing it. Right here in verse 10, it says, and the whole multitude of the people were praying without at the time of incense. Key word in that whole thing is time. They came because it was time. Do you all worship when you're at home? You can worship at home. You don't have to wait until Sunday morning at 10:30 to come here and worship. You can worship at home. You should worship at home by reading and praying and talking to your family about God. But they did it because it was time. We get into a pattern that we come to church, so you know we're gonna worship at a certain time. It almost become like the way we eat. I think I say like the way we eat. People, Christians, us in America, a lot of us don't even know what it feels like to be hungry. People know what it feels like to be hungry. Talk to a missionary lady from South Africa, they eat twice a week. That's being hungry, folks. You eat twice a week. But we get to the point of, we do things, it's 12 o'clock, it's time to eat. I ain't hungry, but I'm eating because it's 12 o'clock. This is 6:30, 6, 7 o'clock. This is sometime, it's time to eat. I ain't hungry, but I'm eating because it's sometime. That's what we do. And that's what we kind of do when it comes to worship. We get in that pattern. Well, it's time to go to church. Let me get ready, get my shower, go to church. You get into that custom. You get in a routine of doing things. But we come in here to meet with God.
Amen.
That's what we come in here for, to feel his presence in our lives. That's what we come in here for. You got to come in here hungry and thirsty for God.
Amen.
That's what you got to come in here for, hungry and thirsty for God.
That's good.
Okay? That's what you got to have. That's what you want. You want to meet with him. You want to feel him. It's an unbelievable feeling when you feel, you know, when you feel it. It's a feeling you'll never forget.
Amen.
You'll never forget it. You got to come in here saying, God, I'm out in this dirty, nasty world, and I'm hungry for you. I want you to fill my soul with you.
That's good.
Just fill me up.
Amen.
Fill me up. That's what you have to want.
Amen.
And that's what you come here for, people. That's what I come here for, to fill it.
Yeah.
To fill it. In verse 21, it says, and the people were waiting for Zacharias and marveled that he tarried so long in the temple. He just stayed in the temple. He was overwhelmed at what happened. He couldn't get up and leave. He had to just stay there. And people were like, time to go. Where are you at? He's in there praising God. He's up in the church, up in the temple praising God. They're like, it's time to go, Zach. It's time to go to the house. He said, not me. We staying. And I know we get like that on a Sunday morning. He's like, preacher, you better hurry up. I gotta go to lunch. I gotta get down to Brandon to get my lunch. I gotta get down to Brandon to get my lunch, preacher. Come on, I gotta beat the Methodists down there. You gotta cut me loose. Ain't that right? You know? But when you meet with God, it don't matter. It don't matter if you're a little bit late. You know, you got that friend coming over at 12:30, or a cousin or somebody coming over at 12:30. You meet with God, sometimes they got to wait.
That's right. Amen.
You're waiting on the football game coming on 1 o'clock. I love football, but we ain't worried about the NFL right now. We ain't here talking about God. Or you want to got a TV program you want to watch when you get home. Now when God's filling you up, it don't make no difference.
That's right.
It don't make no difference what's waiting on you. It'll wait.
Amen.
It'll wait. Because God's number one. God is number one. It will wait. We seem to get surprised when God shows up. Ain't that what we're here for?
That's right.
That is what we are here for. Don't be surprised when God shows up. Because we call for him to come down here and talk to us.
That's right.
Fill us, visit us, be with us. Just be happy to meet God. Be happy to meet God. I'm going to jump back to verse 11. And it says that they appeared to him, an angel of the Lord, and standing on the right side of the altar. God shows up and everybody kind of blows their mind. What God doing here? Well, ain't that what we're here for? Ain't that what you're asking for? Ain't that what you're calling down? You're asking for God to come. And then he shows up and you're shocked. You're shocked. When I read this stuff, when I read these stories in the Bible, I plug myself into that story. like I'm part of it. I'm one of the people when they're praying with me. Now, y'all, and this makes it so much more real to me when I put myself right in that position. And that's why I ask you, what did they come for? They're shocked that God showed up. What did they come for? They just come because that's what they're supposed to do. Come to see God. Come to meet Him. To feel that Holy Spirit in you. That's what we come for. Did you come because it's your religious obligation? That's what you're supposed to do? Or did you come to feel Him?
Amen.
You know, I say, I'm listening. I'm listening for God. I want to feel His glory. His glory is like no other glory. Ain't like watching your team win a football game. I know it's crazy to talk about football all the time because we do. We talk about food and football. I know. And chicken. But we come here to meet with Him. And we just want to feel His power. Now I'm going to get into my 3 points. I got 3 points. Wendy back there smiling. He said, he got 3 points. He done talked 15 minutes already. In verse 13, it says, but the angel said unto him, fear not, Zacharias. These next 5 words, I love to hear this. For thy prayer is heard. Woo! Like I told you the other week, God has 3 ways to answer our prayers. He can say no, He can say not yet, and He can say yes. And I love it when God says yes. I love it when He says yes. He said yes enough to me that I keep coming praying to Him. Yeah. I hear enough yeses that I keep coming to Him. Yeah. You know, if you don't hear no yeses, it's hard to keep praying. But when you hear them yeses, oh yeah.
What do you mean?
You keep putting it on Him. Keep putting it on Him. But if you look at that, the homicide, Zacharias gave up on his prayer. Me and Brother David talked about a preacher who prayed 23, 24 years for his son to get saved. His son got saved, now he's a preacher.
Right.
But if he'd have gave up, who knows what would have happened. But he didn't give up. Don't give up on your prayers. The devil's a liar. He wants you to give up on your prayers. When you give up on your prayers, he's won. We're not giving in to the devil. Don't y'all know God is the great I am?
Amen.
He's the great I am. Don't give up on your prayers.
Amen.
Keep praying.
Right.
God wants people to pray for Him. Pray to Him.
Yes.
He said, pray to me. That's your connection with Him. Bring it back and forth. What He wants. In Acts 12, Peter's in prison. Looking at death. They're having a prayer meeting down the road. They're down the road praying. Acts 12, y'all, I'm reading. He's down there praying. Angel comes to him. Says, it's jailbreak time. We're getting up out of here, boy. Bust that gate open. Let them chains off. Let's go. Peter goes on down there. He goes down to the house. He knows what prayer is going on. He gets down there.
That's right.
A woman named Rhoda comes to the door. She looks up. She takes off running. She goes all over the door to Peter. She goes back and says, hey, y'all, Peter's out here. No, Peter's in jail, woman. He's going to jail. What's wrong with you? What's wrong with you? She said, no. Peter's up there. What are you praying for? You praying for him to get out.
Right.
God let him out. What's the problem here? Let him in. Let him in. Because God answers prayers. God is able to answer all our prayers.
Amen.
I'm telling you, He is able.
That's right.
When I come here, I say, God, change me. Make me more like your son. Make me more like your son every day. Make me more like him. But that's what he's there for. They were praying for him and didn't believe it answered. But are we praying not expecting to get our prayers answered? Are we just praying because that's what we do? I pray because I know he's going to answer my prayer. Yeah. May not be the answer I want, but he's going to answer.
That's right.
He's going to answer.
Amen.
Second point. Power display. Power display. Verse 20 and 22. It says, and behold, thou shalt be dumb and not able to speak until the day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season. Then in 22 it says, and when he came out, he could not speak unto them, and they perceived that he had seen a vision in the temple, for he beckoned unto them and remained speechless. I see him now, he come out, he couldn't talk. I see him now, he come out and like this, you know, where it says beckoning, he's trying to do, he's doing hand sign language. He up there saying, pray. She want to have a baby. You know, I can see him doing something like that. You know, I'm going to have me a baby. You know? And they're like, what happened? He can't say nothing. But he's telling them what happened the best that he can. And but it said, you know, in the, let me get this real quick right now. Should be fulfilled in the season, okay? That season that he was speechless was the time that she was pregnant. So we ain't had no children, but I do know that roughly around 9 months is what it takes to carry a baby. Might be a few weeks early, might be a couple weeks later, but around 9 months to carry a baby. So that tells me that he was quiet for 9 months. He was quiet for 9 months. But now I'm looking for performance continued. That's my third point. I'm gonna wrap this up, folks. In verse 20, it says that, behold, thou shalt be dumb and not able to speak until the day that these things are performed, because thou believest not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season. God's performance was, it lasts, folks. When the Holy Ghost gets in you, it lasts. You don't walk up out of here and a day later it's gone. Once you saved, you saved.
Amen.
And the Holy Spirit is in you from now on.
Amen.
That is performance continued. You know, that's where it just keeps going on. And it keeps going on. You know. They told my mama I never walk. I'm walking, I ain't walking great, but I'm walking all right. Amen. You know, that's what I'm talking about. Performance continued. It keeps going on when God does something. When I get up here and do something, that's gone. When we get up here and sing something, that's gone. When God does it, it lasts. When God does it, it lasts.
Amen.
Okay? I'm going to jump over here to verse 57 through 63. I know y'all thinking this man don't win nothing this morning. But I'm going to give you something today. God was working on me on this for 2 weeks. So, and I'm going to read this, 57 through 63. Now Elizabeth, full time, came that she should be delivered, and she brought forth a son. And her neighbors and her cousins heard how the Lord had showed great mercy upon her, and they rejoiced with her. And it came to pass that on the eighth day they came to circumcise the child, and they called him Zacharias, after the name of his father. And his mother answered and said, not so, but he shall be called John. And they said unto her, there is none of the kindred that is called by this name. And they made signs to his father how he would have him called. And he asked for a writing table and wrote, saying, his name is John. And they marveled all.
Amen.
They want to name the baby, they name the baby until the day when they circumcised him. And they want to name him after his daddy. His mama said, no, we want to name John. They said, you can't name nobody John. His daddy ain't John, ain't no John in your family. There ain't no Johns. How you going to name him John? Daddy said, right, name him John. There ain't no John. They ain't even no John in the Old Testament. You read that whole new Old Testament, there ain't no John in there. I seen Adam. I seen Noah. I seen David, Solomon. Name them. You name a bunch of men in the Old Testament. Ain't none of them named John. That's the first John in the Bible. That's the first John. Okay? He got that name 9 months ago. The angel told him what to name
him. Right.
And they remembered. They did what God said to do. They named him what God said to name him. Because I'm telling you, what happens on your darkest day, at your darkest hour, is still when God comes to you, it's still good when it's light. It's still good when it's light, when he comes to you when you're in the dark spot. But they follow what God said to do and name him John. Name him John. They celebrated God's glory by giving them a baby when they thought they wouldn't have one. When they thought they wouldn't even have one. When God tells you to do something, do you surrender and do what he says to do? Do you follow his steps? Do you walk in his footsteps? That's what he wants you to do. I ask you, why do you come? You come to worship him? That's what we're here for. Or do we just come here to sit, soak it in a little bit, like we're watching a TV program? Or we come to worship him? I want to see God do something in your life. I want to see God do something in my life. If we all come here for the right reason, God will do mighty things in this church.
Yep.
Amen.
We all come here for the right reasons.
Amen.
He'll move. I feel him moving today. I hope y'all did.
Amen.
Hope y'all did. You need to come talk to him, altar's always open. I'll pray with you. If you need to accept Jesus as your Savior, there's no time like now. No time like now. I believe she's going to sing a song invitation.
Jesus.
Go ahead and pray and close up today's service, morning service. Thank you, Father, for everything that you do, Father. Thank you for being with us today.
And God, we just love you. And we just want you to lead us and direct us and guide us and keep us safe. Wrap a shield of protection around all your members here in this church and all the ones who wanted to be here and couldn't be here, Father, be with them as well. Father, now I just ask you, if anyone who's not saved doesn't have another opportunity to accept your son before it's eternally too late. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.